Welcome back. So those of you who saw the previous video probably know that my internet is somewhat spotty at the moment. That being said, I'm playing some games that we haven't necessarily seen in a while. We haven't seen necessarily correspondence chess, we haven't seen Go. Basically games that don't require me to stream the game for you to see it. No, I'm sorry. Games that don't require internet access. Things that I'm either willing to play offline and then upload. Because I honestly, for this, I don't gather quite the audience anyway. Or games that can be played online, that we can chat online while I'm playing, despite me not having ability to stream at the moment. So those are the sorts of things I'm doing right now until my internet gets fixed. And in that bucket lies TIS-100. And hopefully I can get the window to capture. Let's see, we want... Oh, it's not there. It's not there. Game capture. TIS-100. Okay, that captures. Still, that should have worked a little bit better. Let me see. Capture any full screen application. Okay, that works. Cool. Hopefully that'll continue working. I don't have a way to see the preview window. And unfortunately, I'm not streaming, so I can't see this through my phone either. So, last we left off. I don't know, we've made a ton of progress. Oh, I'm sorry, the ones that are grayed out, we don't have access to yet. So, like, this one in the lower right, I don't have. I need to repair two more circuits in order to be able to get that. These that say nominal, I think, mean that I've solved them. For example, image test pattern 1. Untitled program. So, yeah, let's just run this. And you'll see that indeed it does create the target image. And just run that to completion. See that 1799 is the cycle count using a single node and 11 instructions. So this is nominally okay. There are ways to use fewer instructions, there are ways to use fewer cycles, but this is a good trade-off. And then we had image test pattern 2. So it alternates black and white and produces this nice checkered layout. Again, did well in terms of performance overall. There are ways to optimize this in terms of node count as well as cycle count and instruction count. But no, we did okay. One I put off doing was sequence reverser. Do I feel like doing that? This is going to be tricky. So the idea is take the input, put it into a stack memory node, and then read it out of the stack. So I could say like move up right, move up down. Move up down. And if I were to run this, you'd see that most of the results I get are incorrect because I am in fact not alternating, I'm not inverting the stack. So this raises the question, well, let me pause the program. This raises the obvious question, how do you use a stack memory node? For that, I should consult the TIS-100 manual. And you can find this manual online. Search your favorite search engine with the search terms TIS-100 reference manual. And this manual's all over the internet as a PDF. So I want to search this document for a stack memory node. Okay, Yeah, the PDF's not searchable. Big surprise there, right? Yeah, it's meant to be physically or manually read rather than searched. Where's. Huh, interesting. Site that you purchased the game from doesn't have the reference manual. The site that advertises the game doesn't have the reference manual. Oh, somebody appears to have typed it out though. Stack memory node. Node type T30. Stack memory node enables read-write access to a large number of values according to a simple stack-based communication protocol. Refer to the model-specific manual to find the capacity of the stack memory node on a particular device. All interaction with the stack memory node is performed through ports. Writing to the stack memory node adds the value to the top of the stack. If the stack is full, the write will block until space becomes available. Reading from the stack memory node removes the top value from the stack and produces that value. If the stack is empty, the read will block until a value is available. Okay. So I want to find a way to time my read based on having a value of a zero. How do I add a zero? Okay. That's actually pretty simple. All right, so we're gonna move this up value down and to the right. Let's see. Gonna call this the loop. Oh, hang on. So I've got to read each value, move up to the accumulator. I want to start by moving zero to the right. So put a zero on the stack. That's going to be the last thing in the stack. Move up to the accumulator. Move up, down. I'm sorry, not up, down. Move the accumulator down. And move the accumulator to the right. One sec, I'm going to move the mic. Hopefully that didn't make too much noise. So, moving the accumulator down and right. But now I need to check, is the value I just read a zero or not? So we need to say jump equal to zero. Oh, hang on. There's a catch here. So we're jumping to label done. Jump if the accumulator. Wait, what? How does jump equal to zero work? Okay, so this was correct. And then I want to take this and put it here. So moving zero right, accumulator up to the accumulator. Right, and then we got to jump to loop. This is actually less painful than I thought. Move up right. Okay, so this is going to be a loop. Moving up into the accumulator. Start. start's going to be move left to the accumulator. Or whatever. Something. Add left. And then when we're done, oh, sorry, we're gonna, if we're equal to zero, first move accumulator down, jump equal to zero back to start, or jump not zero to loop. There we go. So I think this is what we want, is that if we hit a zero in the input, it's going to go onto the stack. Actually, it shouldn't go onto the stack, is the point. Let's see. Let's put everything on the stack. When we hit a zero, skip this routine and just be done. It's just moving the zero down. The zero gets moved down, moves to the right. And this says read from the stack. And then when we hit a zero, then go back to the start. Otherwise, just jump back to the loop. This looks reasonable. Haha, no success. No success. Interestingly, this prints out 96, 42, 38, 42, etc. How did that come to be? You can see all these numbers that got put on the stack. Let's step through it. So you put a 0 on the stack, put a 22, put an 84, put a 98, a 43, 96, I put another 0 on the stack. A gratuitous 0. Oh dear. That's no good. I don't suppose there's an unstep. Oh, so I have to read all the values out here, out of the stack memory node, before I can start. Yeah, okay. Fine. And I can't do stupid things in terms of race conditions either. I have to wait for the stack memory node to be empty. So I have to propagate a signal back to this logic unit to say when I'm done reading values. Because these things get popped off the stack when I read them. So I need to have some kind of bi-directional logic. I have the logic that goes the one direction that says to print out the values. I need the logic that goes the other direction. That's what makes this tricky. This whole time, like the first time I approached this problem, I thought I would have to do something clever, pushing things in and out of the stack. Now the stack is really simple. It's pretty clear what that's intended for. It's just the timing of reading and writing things is incredibly messy. You saw the input just kept writing to the stack as we're trying to read from it. And that's absolutely no good. The input's got a buffer until the stack is empty. There's no operation to check for an empty stack. Okay. The instruction manual says the stack memory nodes are typically connected to other nodes, etc., etc. Simultaneous reads and writes are resolved in an undefined order, but each individual communication will behave according to the described communication protocol. That's no good.
So what do we do? Read the sequence from in, reverse the sequence, and write it to out. It's like my node in the center here has to keep a count. And this upper node has to have two loops. Because without that counter, I'm not going to be able to keep track of how many instructions got executed. Okay, so let's start down here. Add left. Just basically read from the left. Okay. Jump non-zero loop. Yeah, let me rethink my architecture here. Rather than try to fit my program into what's already here. Move up, right. Next is going to be move right up. Okay. That's my architecture that I need to work with. Add left. And this is going to end with move zero left. I mean, I could even say move accumulator left. It doesn't really matter. I could say move left to accumulator, which is going to be my clue that I need to start reading out of the stack. So reading out of the stack is going to be move up to accumulator. This is going to be our loop. Again, this looks going to look familiar to what we just had, but I'm doing it from scratch so I don't confuse myself. It's a lot easier to tear the circuit apart and redo it from scratch than to try to incrementally make changes and make it work. Move up to the accumulator, move accumulator down, and if we're non-zero, jump back to loop. So this is also going to print out the terminating zero, which is okay. And then when we're done, we're going to move a signal left and move that back up. This is going to start with move. Sequences are zero terminated, it says. Move zero onto the stack memory node. This is going to get ugly, but that's okay. Right. And then we'll say start is actually here. Move zero down. No, I'm not ready to do that yet. It's only when we encounter a zero that we're going to be moving it down. Eventually it's going to say move zero down. And then we're going to have wait. So reading, yeah, in fact, yeah, loop is actually appropriate here. I forget if wait is a command proper or not, so I think I can use that as a label. Move down to accumulator. And then we're going to say jump start. I could add an extra node here to do something in parallel, but that'd be silly. Okay, so we jump back to the start, which is going to say move up into the accumulator. Move the accumulator right. This is actually going to be our main loop. Alright, I was thinking I was going to have two loops here, but no, this is just waiting for a signal. So take the accumulator, move it right, and if the accumulator... Oh wait, I'm sorry, if we're equal to zero, we don't want to move that right. We just want to skip to this part. Jump equal to zero to done. Else jump back to the loop. Now does this make sense? Probably not. Because I wrote it. Let's start taking out this last jump. And this is okay, I guess. Right, because that last zero we get on the input, we don't want to put on the memory stack. Okay. Move zero right, so that's going to be the bottom of the stack. Move right into, or move up into the accumulator. If the value in the accumulator is zero, jump to done. Done is going to say signal down here, which signals this in turn that it's time to read. And then just wait until this signals us back that it's ready. That looks sane. Oh, beautiful. Oh my goodness. That worked perfectly. 398 cycles. There's a lot of idle time in this. This circuit is like 70 to 80% idle. Because there's only so much that can be done at once. Now, question is, we got two stack memory nodes. Can you do anything clever? Like, this is apparently the typical solution. Using only four nodes and using the stack memory count. This passed the test. So the question is, can you do anything clever using both stack memory nodes? Parallelization is the word. I think so. But before we mess this up, this is one case where I'm actually going to take this program and try to improve it. But before I try to do anything clever, we're going to go back to the segment list, copy this, and then this is what we're going to try to improve. So note that not all sequences are the same length. Some length sequences are zero terminated and only contain a zero. There's all kinds of finesses to worry about here. I wonder, if I were to take this first instruction, move zero right out, and put it instead here, as the first thing you do. Move zero up. Would that work? Yeah, okay, so I shaved off 11 cycles doing that. That was clever. But the point of that wasn't to be clever. The point of that was to see, is there some way to that I could start splitting this program up and distributing it among these nodes. Let's take a look at the communication failure. Microcode dump. When I get into a groove working on this machine, it feels like I'm in the presence of another, a feeling that understands me. Forget all about a life that pains me and drags me down. I want to be a tessellated intelligence. Take inputs, process, take inputs, process, take, perceive, understand. Now, I'm curious Oh, I'm sorry. I can't read from this module. I can only write to it. I have not tried writing to it. In particular, with the stack memory node right next to it, I'm curious what would happen. And I'm curious to what extent it's going to chomp things out of the stack that I need. Here, let's just do something malicious. Let's just write a ton of numbers down. Actually, what happens if I start moving stuff down? And just keep adding one each time. Okay, yeah, this used an extra node for no good reason. I was kind of expecting that this would do something silly. This node is not accepting input. At least not from the stack, it isn't. One left. Run. Huh. Yeah, apparently that module out there is just not consuming anything. I'm not sure how we know that. Other than... What other things could I try here? Like, move one down. Or I could try, I'm not sure. Like, we don't know what's up with this node over here. So, I don't know. Like, I'm not sure what to feed into that node that's failing. Apparently it doesn't matter. Apparently this module's not communicating with the rest of the circuit, even though it's connected. So that's good and a bad thing. I could try every possible input value, feeding it into that. It would take a long time. I could try flooding the stack memory node and see, like, if there are too many values in the stack, does anything strange happen? Left zero. Let's just put a whole bunch of zeros. Oops. I can't move left zero. I can move zero to left. Oh, and the stack's full. Right. So, yeah. Apparently that's it for this. I was thinking I was going to try to use both stack memory nodes, but I'm really wary about doing that while this is attached to this out here. Like, this faulty node could consume my input at any moment, and I wouldn't be able to trace it. So I'm a bit wary of using the stack memory node there. Let's go back to our program list. I'll think more about that over time. So this is the one that outperformed the other one, right? This took 385. Right, this still takes 385. Let's go back to the list. I want the one that takes 385 to be the first thing. Oh, man. Kill myself here, man. Move zero up. So that takes 385. Okay, go back to the segment list. Go to number two here. Erase number two. There we go. Back to the list. So you solved everything in the first row, everything in the second row, third row, fourth row. That brings us to row number five here. So, signal window filter. Read the values from in, write the sum of the last three values to out.3 and the sum of the last five values to out.5. Assume prior values are zero. Okay, you get two stack memory nodes. Oh, that's gonna be painful. All right. So you would think, I don't know, people have done this sort of puzzle before. You got out.3 and out.5 down there. Got a faulty communication module. Yes, this machine was built to be used. CF09H. It has observed some, not just anything, like a camera. Something specific. Its memory still contains the last thing it saw. Oh. Wow. Well, that's not creepy at all. Just kidding, but, well, there's apparently a backstory to some of this here. Who knew? So is there some way I can keep track of what was the number that was three numbers ago, and what was the number that was five numbers ago? I'm not thinking that that's feasible. So this looks very challenging. Not because of the specification of the program, but because we have to do it on that circuit board, and given that circuit board layout. Let's go to sequence indexer. Sequences are zero terminated. Read a sequence, read index values, look up index value in sequence, write indexed value to out. Okay. Sequences are zero terminated. Read a sequence, read input values. Oh, we got two read things. Okay. Also, we got a node. Whoa! Structures of the past persist and become memory. That memory, the present again. Something new. Lie covering what was lost. Soon now. Okay. If you say so. Sequences are zero terminate. Oh. Okay, so these are zero-based lookups. It's like, you have a sequence starting at 860. Oh no, this is the output. Oh, the input sequence is meant to be used for all of the tests. Gotcha. Okay. So read in the input sequence, and we're going to repeatedly be reading that and not forgetting that. Okay. And then looking up the nth value. Wow. Okay, sequence is zero terminated. Sequence comes in here, so it's going to be move up accumulator. This is going to be our loop. Actually, we're going to call this start move up accumulator, move accumulator right. And jump equal or jump not zero back to start. Our remaining loop is gonna be, yeah, move move down to right. Oh. Wow. Unfortunately, I can't use the word loop. Okay, and then jump end. And then this down here is going to be move right up. This is going to be move up to the accumulator. Move accumulator right. Move accumulator up or left. And so the values are going to cycle around and around here. Oh, but I can't. Damn it. So this complicates things. Yeah, to buffer things properly, I wonder if I should use both stack memory nodes, because I can make a proper circuit here. Let's see. So we're going to take all the value. No, things get inverted as we put them back on the stack, so we have to uninvert them, pushing them through the other stack memory node. Move right back up. This is going to be move down up. Okay. Wow. Okay. What do I do? Well, can we at least verify that this sends the values around in a loop? And simplify some of this, taking out the accumulator. Move down right. So this should, in theory, go in a loop, but the timing of it is messed up. We have to wait until this. We've read all the numbers of the sequence into the node. This has to, like, move 0 to the right. And then I have to put this program somewhere else. Like here. Changing all of my stuff. Okay, changing up and down. Actually up and right. Okay, let's try this again. We're going to prepend a 0, read the sequence into the stack memory node. I'm just going to read it. We're going to need to put it in accumulator here, and then move the accumulator down, and so forth. And then this stack memory node on bottom will unmess things up. So this needs to just read what came off the stack, but it needs to wait until we have a 0. Yeah, timing of this is really confusing. I want to create a loop where it just sends the values around and around and around. That's tricky. But it does require both stack memory nodes. There's no reasonable way that I can think of to do it for any arbitrary sequence. So. Jump not 0 to start. If we're equal to 0, we're going to move 0 down. This is going to be a loop. Jump to the loop. Jump non-zero to the loop. It's going to start by move up, down. Do this loop until we hit a 0. At which point we'll need to repeat this stuff. Move up into accumulator, and then we start. Move right. Add right. It's the same as move up to the right. Oh, that's not right. That's not what we want, though. Move right into the accumulator. I hate using single character labels. I have no way around it here. Yeah. I'm gonna use S then. And then move accumulator up and jump not zero back to S. And then if we hit a 0, unfortunately, the last number of the sequence is 0. That's kind of a problem. Move right up. Yeah, and then it'll read all the non-zero values, and then eventually encounter a 0. My goodness. Maybe I use negative 1 to denote the other end of the sequence. Maybe not. Maybe that's not a good idea. Okay, so we read out all the values, and then we wait for a signal to come back down. Now, this up here is stuck in an infinite loop. Move down to the right. Actually, this should first be preceded with move down right, and then only then we're going to say move down into the accumulator. Can actually put a space here now. Move accumulator to the right and jump not zero back to second loop. So I think this should at least communicate the values around and around and around in circles. Then we could say move left down, and we could say move up down, so we could get some things printing. Okay, so I hit a terminal condition where something's stuck. A terminal condition where something's stuck, I say. As if that's different than some other kind of terminal condition. Right, so I've read all the values. My instructions are stuck trying to read things. I don't have any kind of blocking. Valiantly I attempted to not lose my values. It turns out reading and writing involving multiple stacks is tricky. Who could have guessed? So, So what do I do when I hit the zero at the end of the input sequence? I don't like my program at all. I want to figure out, is there a way that once I hit this zero at the end, I can just terminate? Like, what are my instructions? Instruction set. Is there a way I can just, like, die on a node? And just say no op for the rest of eternity. JRO0 will do that. Okay. I'm going to try something different here. I don't like the approach I took. So what I'm going to do is going to be move up into accumulator. Move accumulator right. J jump not equal to zero, loop JRO 0. And that's gonna cause an infinite loop there. This here is gonna have two modes, loop 1, loop 2. Loop 1's gonna, okay, I need to put a 0 on the front of this, move 0 to the right. So loop 1 is going to be pushing the values from the top to the bottom. Loop 2 is going to be pushing the values back from the bottom to the top. Hopefully I can fit that all on a single node. Move up to accumulator. And then what do I do? Move accumulator right, move accumulator down. And then we have to repeat that stanza like this. Unless I would just want to do something special with that first zero, and maybe I do. In fact, that first zero can just go straight down, because that's not part of the sequence. If we're not equal to zero, jump back to loop one. Loop two. Read the values back from stack two back up to stack one. But before loop 2, we have to have an extra instruction that says move down, back to up. Because that's going to be a 0. And then move down accumulator. This is going to bug the hell out of me, but I can't use full label names. So it's part of the experience. Move is not, does not have an E. Move down to accumulator, move accumulator, up, and jump not zero, back to L2. So, I think that'll ping and pong the values up and down and up and down. And then we could say move left, down, and we could say move, move up, down, just to get a sense of things going back and forth. All right, somehow things aren't going as they should. Wait, there's not a zero in the middle of the sequence, so what's going on? We pushed a zero, an 860, 215, 784. I missed 230. How did I miss the 230? There's a timing issue between my circuits, because I'm not reading and writing at the same pace. That's how I missed the 230. This says 4 instructions, this is 5. So, I could wait for a step. I guess that's kind of what I got to do. Nope. Just don't do anything for a step. So we got a loop, 2, 3, 4 steps in the loop. This says 4 steps in its loop, so we're okay there. So yeah, we should observe. In fact, to get rid of that noise, let's do that. And then to actually see the values going back and forth, move left to accumulator. Okay, let's try that. So you can see the values going up and down and up and down and up and down, except for the 978, which somehow didn't make it into the sequence. Everything other than the 978 worked fine, but the 978 itself didn't fit. That's just weird. How did that 978 get put out of the sequence? 0, 860, 215, 230, 784, 900, 945. So I missed something. I'm not reading fast enough to keep up with my writes. How am I reading and writing at different speeds? I'm confused. Okay, let's try that again. Step that one step at a time again. Show me. I mean, this is always ready to read a value. So we have 215, 230. Move that into the accumulator. 230 is going to the right. Move the accumulator down. Jump nose. Okay. Oh, we're trying to write and read at the same time. Fine, let me move my no operation instruction here. See if that affects. No, that didn't fix anything. Weird. What if I put an extra do nothing operation in there? Then does everything go up and down just fine? Okay. Does anybody understand the difference? There's a timing issue here somewhere, but I don't see it. Ultimately, it doesn't matter. I'd like to understand it rather than work around it. But yeah, you can see the two stacks are oscillating all the values back and forth, as they should. I don't get it. I do not understand. So, what are we looking at? I mean, yeah, the way this is written, the test is never going to end. I'm okay with that outcome. I'd still like to understand what happened. Um, Also, I gotta figure out how to index into that, but at least I have access to the whole sequence now. So, the very amusing thing is, read index value or values from in.x, look up the index value in the sequence, write the indexed value to out. Oh, zero there is an index too. Okay. What do you do? I finally got the sequence, so I'm not losing the data. I still don't understand why there was a timing challenge there, because I've got a read that's taking the value from up, putting it in the accumulator, skipping two instructions, and then writing and then jumping back up to the loop. Whereas this is just taking the value up, moving it to the right, or to the accumulator, from the accumulator right, from the accumulator down, and then jumping back to the loop. So that's four instructions. Let's watch the timing of this. I didn't mean to double click. Click, click. Okay. Move up into the accumulator. Now this is trying to read from that. There's still nothing in the stack to be read. So step, step. Okay. Okay, so this has to wait for something to show up on the stack. And that begins its loop. One, step, two, three, four, five. So this is still waiting on the stack memory node is the point. Is there any better way to synchronize any of this? Like I could reduce the number of instructions by saying read from the stack before attempting to write the next value. Would just slow things down, I think, but that would handle this contention issue. Does it really matter where these no-op instructions are? I'm curious. So the stack goes back up and down and up and down and preserves its ordering this way. 860, 215, 230, 784, 900, 978, etc. It's all there. Now, this is... funny thing here. I don't want to be doing what I'm doing here. I want to actually switch these two loops. In terms of which one prints off to the right and which one doesn't. Which probably means one fewer instruction over here. Move up into the accumulator, move up, down, jump. Let's try running that and see if we lose all our values. No, this seems okay. Okay. So, yeah, this is always reading or waiting. So, the next challenge is indexing into that. You have to keep track of an accumulator as well as the sequence that's going back and forth here. Interesting thing is, like, I could try doing asynchronous reads and writes out of the stack memory node. Because as long as the value's there when it needs to be for this to propagate it back up, it's okay. That sounds like a terrible idea. Never mind. Move up, down, and this is going to be... this always needs to be ready to read the value from the left when... I don't even know how I'm going to split up the work here, because there's timing issues galore with this stuff. I don't get it. I do not understand. Left to accumulator. Huh. What do you do? What do you do? And then we need to swap. And then check if the value from up is equal to the index, and if so, etc., etc. But, oh boy. Also, sequences are zero terminated, but I have no way of checking the length of the sequence, so I don't know any, I don't have any way to check when I'm done. Actually, maybe what I do. Huh. Yeah, the fact that I don't have a way to check the length is very problematic. If I want the nth element, I have to count from the beginning. So, how do I know when I've run out of values? Node in the middle is pinging and ponging between the two nodes, the complete sequence. But this node on the right doesn't need both zeros. That's the problem. Okay. Move down, up. Oh, right. I'm sorry. This is only going to print the zero at the end of the sequence, as it should. So I'm going to entitle this loop and then say jump not zero back to loop. And step one is going to be move up, down. That's going to be this module that has to figure out what to print out. Move up accumulator swap. Oh my goodness. The idea of indexing, where you have the index and the sequence of values, that's a mess. So move up to the accumulator, swap. And then this is where our loop begins, where we have our sequence of values ending in a zero. Move up into accumulator. Swap, jump, not equal to zero into the loop, If our index is 0, then we're going to swap, move accumulator down, swap again, and then jump back to loop. Then having printed the last value, that's interesting, the output never needs a 0. Whatever. Let's allow the output to have a 0. This says jump loop, but this should be like jump not 0 loop. And if we're 0, then go back to the loop and keep indexing, etc., etc. Move up into the accumulator. This is just wrong, though, because at some point I have to decrement the index. How do I decrement that index? Jump not 0 back to loop. I have to add 1 to the index before I do that. Move 1 into the accumulator, and then we're going to say add up. Swap, and then for each loop, we're going to subtract 1. Hang on. And then do our swap instruction after having subtracted 1. What did this say? I'm just confusing myself badly. Jump not 0 loop. I mean, what I'm doing is probably okay. I just can't explain it. So 5 is incorrect. It's an off by 1 error. That's scary. Hang on. We're going to say move up into the accumulator. That'll be that. Loop, subtract 1, put it into memory. Et cetera, et cetera. Run. That's also wrong. Let's say move 1 into the accumulator, add up, move accumulator down. So we do 1 based indexes here. And what do we got this time? 6 is wrong in a most amusing fashion. 5 is wrong in a less amusing fashion. Up into the accumulator, swap. This is not good. Let's try to do it in a way that I can explain to people. Boop. Okay. No. We need to subtract the 1 and then swap. 1 being our index. Cache that away in the backup register. Read the input value. Put it in, swap the accumulator and backup. If we're not 0, just loop, subtract 1, and so forth. Else, swap, print out the value in the accumulator, swap back, and then go back to the loop. Unless we have a 0, meaning we've read the entire input sequence. How is this failing? Is there some stupid timing issue? There's no way. I mean, I don't even see where it gets a 6 or a 5 from. Six, five, nine, four. It's just reading the numbers in this sequence are the ones that are getting printed out. As opposed to the nth number. Oh. Well, this is dumb. Move left into accumulator. I need to print out the sequence before I jump back. 697 is incorrect. Is that the only thing we're going to get? That seems to be the only output value. I broke it again. So. First we push the index into this. Then take the values out of the sequence and print them out. Why am I even doing this involving the accumulator? Why don't I just move it down directly? Oh, because I need to compare is that last value of the sequence is 0. But I'm doing that incorrectly as well. Let's see. This said move down up, and this should also say move 0 right? No, 0 should be the last thing. Oh, that means I had it right in the first place. Of course. Let's switch this back up. We have to add another no operation instruction there, that's okay. Then I can run this. Oh my goodness. Hey, we got one value correct. Let's be happy for that. And we haven't corrupted the sequence here either. So far so good there. Yeah, we're progressing through these inputs, but how this is failing is confusing me. Okay, subtract one, swap. $860 goes into there. Jump not 0 to loop. Swap. Move the accumulator down. That's our 860. Swap. Jump back to loop. Or jump not 0 to loop. That's not supposed to be jump not 0 on that value. Supposed to be jump not 0 on. It doesn't matter what we're printing. Hang on. This is where I screwed up. This needs to do something more clever. So, this prints out the value. Um, So move up to the accumulator. This is where we need to jump equal to zero back to start. So if we read in a zero, oh, here we go, jump back to eight. There's probably a better way to write this that doesn't have as many instructions, but so as we're reading values from the sequence, if we encounter a zero in the sequence, go get the next index, and so forth. It's 60, 978. Yeah, we got the correct numbers now. Oh my goodness. In terms of cycle count, that was hideous. Node count, that was okay. Instruction count, that was okay. But that's about one of the slowest sequence indexers that you could possibly write. So, point is, I've invented a protocol where the index is the first thing passed, and then I subtract one from the index on each iteration of the loop. And just keep looping forever. And if you encounter a zero in the sequence, then go back and get the next index. And as you keep decrementing the loop counter, if your decremented counter is equal to zero, then it's time to print the value. So, obviously the next question is there a more idiomatic way to do any of this? The answer is yes, but how? I have no idea. Not a clue. I think it would involve asynchronous reads and writes. This is all synchronous through these two nodes. This writing to the first stack and reading from the first stack is synchronous. Or I'm sorry, asynchronous, but everything else is synchronized through this node and through this node. So it's not possible to lose values of the sequence due to some stupid timing issue. The funny thing is, like, if you had a loop here, it would be possible to write 10 instructions or something. You could write instructions that say, like, read the whole sequence and then just keep passing it around in a loop, like a physical loop of nodes. Because we have these two stack memory nodes, we have to, when we're passing these values around, they get inverted. And then they get re-inverted. It's just all kinds of mayhem. And there's not enough room on the stack, like, for all these tests. Let's say take these input values. There's 10 input values or something of that nature. I haven't counted these exactly. This has got to be somewhere around 10. And there's not enough room to write 20 instructions that say, read all the input values, read and write them, and then go back through the loop or something like that. That was horribly unclear and probably wrong. I'm saying, like, there's not a simple hardware solution to this problem. I'm forced to use the stacks because they're in my way. They really do nothing to help me. They do a lot to hinder me. But they could, in theory, help me if I were using them asynchronously. But I'm not. Just using this one node in the middle to push everything back and forth and back and forth between the two stacks, which is terribly inefficient. But I don't have a better solution. I mean, one thought would be, I can't block on Yeah, that's the other issues. Because the stacks are in the way, I can't do I/O blocking to make sure that things are properly synchronized here. In theory, what I could do, which would be disgusting, it'd be I could just have the loop values going around and around in a loop down here, avoid the stack memory nodes entirely. I'd need to have a way to propagate the values from top all the way to the right and make sure they keep looping and I don't lose any value and that the sequence starts over, but I'm not sure how to do that. In theory, that would expedite things. Because then each iteration I could check, is this the nth iteration and so forth. But the other thing that would help is like if each of these nodes had n accumulators and just say index into register n. You'd be, that's what we're trying to do is we're writing an indexer. So there's no hardware solution that simplifies this. Stored image decoder. Let's see the requirement. Read a color length from in, read a color value from in, draw a line of that length and color, wrapping when the edge of the screen is reached. What? What's the challenge here? I think the only challenge is remembering the protocol, right? Oh no. No, you have to keep track of the X and Y positions that you're reading and writing at. That's the challenge. Okay. You got tons of nodes in which to keep track of all these things, but wow. that doesn't look simple at all. So yeah. Move one down. Hey, look at all the things I'm writing. Isn't that exciting? So one's a color, one's a row, one's a column. So I could just keep saying move one down and then just never end that sequence, never put a zero on the end of it. But, to do this, you'd have to take the work I did for the other graphics thing, which writes things vertically, and now change it to write them horizontally or something like that. It's doable. Anything's doable, but it's a lot of work here. Not feeling up to coding that at the moment. So let's go back to the list. There's a sequence sorter. How about that? Sequences are zero terminated. Read a sequence from in, sort the sequence, and write the sorted sequence to out. Okay. So, how do you do bubble sort with stack memory nodes? Is basically the question. You have to know when you've hit the termination of the sequence. Thankfully it doesn't want you to put the zero at the beginning. That would be silly. But thankfully that's not required. The solution would be you read in a value, put it onto the stack, and have basically a way that says take the values on the stack and insert the new value at the correct position. And then you could, when you encounter a zero, just write everything out. Let's see. Move up, down. Move up, down. Move up, right. See, it's only mostly wrong. We're just missing the part that says take the things that are already in the stack and insert this where it belongs. And I think you do need both stack memory nodes to achieve such a thing. They have multiple registers, but they toggle the ordering each time you insert, each time you read and write. This could get messy. I'm not sure how to do this. Let's see this. Seeing is a form of control. And if you can see something for its true essence, you will be so tired. Eyes need rest. Eyes need rest too. Alright, well that was interesting. I'll come back to that when I'm in a more creative mood. That looks challenging as all hell. Signal window filter looks doable. Signal divider looks challenging. Oh, you need to figure out divide X by Y, write out the quotient and remainder. In theory, this doesn't sound too bad. So I'm not seeing any value to using the stack memory nodes for this problem. Just have to remember what the... No, you actually don't have to remember the input value at all. Move up into accumulator. Move up to the left. Oh. So... quotient and remainder. Well, that's just enough things that I can't fit all the values I want in a single node. Is it? I have to have some way of indicating. Move up left. I'm sorry, move up into the accumulator. Move accumulator left. Swap. Move left into accumulator. And then jump. Not zero, back to loop. Okay. Meanwhile, this is going to be... so that's going to keep sending the other value, B, into A. So we moved up into the accumulator. Let's just say jump greater than zero loop. Oh, there's no way to take the two values and jump greater than zero loop. So what can I do here? Move up into the accumulator. Yeah. So we're gonna do it. Loop here is gonna be subtract right. And then what? Move. Let's see. Yeah, I want to print a 1 or a 0. Move 1 right. Jump greater than or equal to 0. I don't have such an instruction. I've got a jump less than 0. I've got a jump equal to zero, jump not zero, got a negate, less than zero, hey, so, I'll just have two jumps, that's okay. I'll just say jump less than zero back to start. And then say jump loop. That's inefficient. It works though, right? No. It's not what I'm looking for, because I still need to write out the values. It's just going to say move. Move. Let's see. Wait, add right. What a mess. For greater than zero, just keep looping and looping. Add right, and oh, I didn't keep track of the quotient, just the remainder. That was accidental. That's what I was saying earlier, is that I have just not enough memory for a single module to keep track of both the quotient and the remainder and the where I'm currently at. We have two nodes here. How come I don't have the space to do this? Oh, I do have the space. What am I thinking? Loop. Swap. Add one. Swap. Subtract right, etc., etc. Loop, etc., etc. Move. Wait. Yeah, move accumulator down. Swap. Move accumulator down. Move zero right. And then start the program over again. Which means that this jump greater than zero to start. It's not what we're looking for. Hang on. I still have an off by one problem. Yeah, that's a mess and a half. Because we only want to add one. We're not already equal to zero. Hi. So let's use this as a scratch pad and pretend it's over here, but I'm gonna write over here. Move up accumulator. Swap. Add one. Swap. Hang on. Is it possible that the number, I don't see any examples where the input in that are, I don't see any example where both inputs are the same integer. Now there's a more efficient way to, if b is equal to 1, that's pretty clear what the quotient and remainder are. You could execute a special routine in that case. I'm not doing that right now, but you could. Up into accumulator. Actually, could I check that? Let's check that. Sub 1. Jump equal to 0, done. To 1. 1 is going to be move. I'm not sure that I want to do this. It would speed things up considerably, but I don't think I have the space in the node for it. Quotient and remainder. Hang on. That's not even this input. I'm confusing myself terribly. Yeah, I'm let me try doing this very differently. Move up into the accumulator. Before we do any of this, move 0 into the accumulator, swap. And there might be a way to clear the backup register, but... back is non-addressable, and there's no way to clear the value. Oh, SAV is to save the value. Okay, whatever. We put 0 in the accumulator, swap it, up in the accumulator. Oh, but now I have no way of checking. Yeah, that's no good either. I'll have to do the subtraction on the left node. Take the result, put it back in the accumulator. Alright, so the left node's going to do all the math for us. Swap. Add one. Hang on. Get this result back. Now, at each iteration of this loop, I do need to increment the thing. You need to increment the quotient. There's no way to say jump not equal to 1. Okay, take the input, put in the accumulator, swap. I think I want to change the order of those instructions, because each loop I'm going to begin by adding 1. To the quotient, swapping, moving left, doing the subtraction operation, taking the subtraction result, putting it here, and if we're greater than 0, we're going to jump back to the loop, and then when we're done, we want to print out the quotient and remainder. Move, let's swap, move accumulator down, swap, move accumulator down. That's what we want to do. And this here will do the subtraction for us. Move up into the accumulator. Oh, hang on. And move 0 left. Wait, no, the thing on the left can detect when we hit the end of our operation. And this is going to be move up down, move up left. I don't even need to swap these two. Can do it like that. And then we could say move up, down, move up, left, move right, down. Okay, so read in the number. Sub left. Move accumulator right. Jump greater than 0 back to loop. That should work. I say. Move accumulator left, sub left. Oh, I'm sorry, this should not be sub left. This should be subtract the value from the right node. There we go. Incorrect, 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 incorrect. Perfect. Music to my ears. Fascinating. Jump greater than zero loop. Let's try it this way. Does this work any better? Not really. At least with the other thing, I had something that halfway seemed reasonable. Okay. Add one to the quotient. Swap the numbers. Yeah, if I'm going to add one to the quotient, I have to swap and then add one. Which means during my initial load, I've got to do it in the reverse order, which is what I just did. Quotient 0, read the divisor, increment the loop counter, or the quotient. Move accumulator left, move left accumulator, jump greater than 0 loop. Move up to the accumulator, subtract right, move accumulator back to the... How does this not work? Okay, so we got a 47 and a 3. Forty-four is definitely greater than 0. Okay, accumulator contains 44. Is my problem. That's not what we wanted the accumulator to contain. We wanted the accumulator to contain the difference. So how do I then signal this that I'm done? Is the problem. Because now this will never terminate. I need a way to keep track of the state and of the divisor and dividend. How do I keep track of state, divisor, and dividend all in the same node? Like, even if I push that responsibility as I originally coded into this left node, I don't have space for it there either. That's a problem. That's saying I have to use a stack, even though I really, really, really don't want to. Because I've only got two registers on a node, and I need three. Unless there's some really... I mean, I could use the upper right node to hold some state for me. What a mess. Or, I might need three nodes to keep track of three states, is the upshot. I don't have three nodes to keep track of three states. Adding a third node could complicate things significantly. Wait, this node here isn't using its backup register. So I think I have to code what I was originally doing, which is hugely complex. Or we've got to figure out how to use a stack memory node to help me, which I don't think is going to make things any simpler. What a mess. So... yeah, if you've got ideas, you've probably already looked at the forum, or you're just really good at this game. So kudos to you. It's going to have to be this node on the left that figures out when we've hit our terminus condition. And then signals to the right, hey, guy on the right, we're done. You don't have to keep, no, really, you don't have to keep subtracting. Okay. Yeah, that sort of thing. That's got to be done. The other fun thing is handling the zero condition. When a number evenly divides into another number, so the remainder is zero. Detecting the end condition for that is going to, or how to print that is going to be fun. I think that's challenging. Yeah, and I don't think these jump. I think these jump instructions only consider the value in the accumulator. Instruction after the label will be executed if the accumulator is positive. JRO. Transfer execution unconditionally on the offset specified by source. Oh my goodness. I could use JRO for signaling things. I've made it through so many of these problems and not figured out that JRO is like hugely extremely important to what I'm doing. Because nodes can send a row number, like you say JRO space left, right? They don't provide that example in their instructions, but you could say jump relative to offset and then have the other node tell you what the offset is. I feel so stupid. Well, at least we made that discovery before the final problem. My goodness, it took me like 25 some puzzles to figure out that that's valid syntax. And here's a condition where you'd actually want to say jump based on something other than accumulator. There were tons of other situations where that also applied, but it's important here. So, I am beside myself with that discovery. It's put me at a point where I'm really flustered that I coded this twice and then came by that really simple discovery and don't know how to tear this apart. Don't have the heart really to take this apart and code it a third time, but I need to. Unless I can figure out how to insert JRO somehow meaningfully into this somewhere. So, first of all, let's get rid of the extra line there. Move accumulator left. And JRO left will tell us what to do next. So we're saying jump greater than zero loop. That's not what we want to do. And when we say move accumulator right, that's also not what we want to do. We want to move something right, but I think what we want to move right is like a negative offset. And then we're going to say move one right. Oh my god. That makes everything look so simple. Yeah. How did I go this many?
so many of these could be optimized so much better just based on that JRO discovery. Let's just run it. Okay, so jump relative to offset. Move accumulator left, move one right. Now, okay. Perhaps this division of work was not the best division of work. Move right into, I don't know. I don't even care at this point. Accumulator. Sure, why not? Run it. 17 and 3. 17 and 6. Let me guess. 17 and something. 29 and 3. 16 and 7. 9. Okay. So it's completely wrong. But I figured out how to use JRO. 58 and 2. So, yeah. All the math is wrong. Now, 17 and 3. I'm off by 2 here. But the rest is just ridiculous. Okay. So now, at least I understand how to use JRO. This actually seems like a sane division of work. Let's add one. Swap. Move up into the accumulator. Each loop on the accumulator is going to be moving the accumulator left. And then always adding one. And that's going to be our quotient. And at some point we need to compare the, well, hang on. Jump greater than zero loop. Subtract the value from the right. Yeah, I'm not sure what to do if we have an equal division. Let's not worry about that just yet. Let's worry about the simple case first. Right to the cum. Wait, why am I moving right to the accumulator again? What the. Oh. No, that. I just need to consume the value from the right. Move one right to say that it can get on with its life and print out the values. Right, so let's run it again. 17 and 2, was it? 17 and 3? 17 and 3. When we divide 47 by 3. Subtract right. Move minus 4 right. Jump loop for greater than 0. Which a great many times we are. Up to cum. Oh. Swap. Move accumulator left. Right. So should be better. Oh, SQP is not the same as SWP. Run. 16 and 3, 13 and 6, 22 and 3. Let me know if you ever find a pattern here, because okay, pattern number one is that quotient is off by one most of the time. Well, let's run it a little bit longer to see what happens if we have an even division. Ha! Okay, we did get an A correct value, but
Yeah, we're off by one most of the time. Subtract right. Okay. Jump equal to zero. Yeah, I need to add a done loop over here. Done. Move one right. But this has to also read the value from the right. Well, one thing at a time. This is going to be not JGZ, but jump loop. This is going to say... how do we handle all this? I'm so confused. Yeah, we have to subtract 4. Move negative 4 right. Subtract right. Jump greater than 0 to loop. If we're equal to 0, we don't need to send minus 4 to the right. Move one right, and then this doesn't really care about the rest, does it? What's the point of all this? Run. Okay. Move accumulator left. So that was our first contention point. Okay, we got a timing issue here. Run. 16 and 3. At least we're off by one. At least the off by one thing could be understood. And I could actually just change this from minus 1 to a minus 2. To address many of these off... No? We're still off by 1 on the remainder. Yeah, our remainder is seemingly random. That should be 62. Okay, we're actually off a different way there. So, okay, this is the world's least predictable division operation. I am quite impressed by just how bad it is. Yeah, I'm beside myself with how... Okay, 69 and 1, it's off. Okay, so I think this also needs to have jump equal to zero loop. Run. Let's see just how far off we're at this time. Alright, so most of the time our quotient is correct. Our remainder is still off by one. Oh, our remainder is just the divisor. Oops. Yeah, I actually do need to communicate the remainder. Let's see. Move one right. And then they're going to say... Oops. But before we do that... Move negative 4 right. jump equal to 0 to loop. That doesn't sound right. Jump equal to 0 is going to be to done. Normally we need to do move minus 4 right, add right. Wait. Okay, which means I need to change my order of instructions here to make this the last instruction of those, and that the first. And we'll see how far off we are this time. Move negative one right would say just give us the accumulator again, because we need to re-add it. Add right. Move one right, and then move accumulator right. Okay. And this here, Sonny, is going to say quotient and remainder are what? Accumulator left, move left down, swap, move the quotient down. Run that. How close are we? 16 and 2. Okay, I don't know why, but I have to initialize this to minus 2 instead of minus 1. Oh, still not good. I thought I had it. It's really close. I think our case where we've got an even divisor, things aren't working exactly the way they need to. So we have a remainder of 0. Here, this needs to be a move minus 4 right. No big deal. I can do that. Sub right. Wait, what's the point in doing it this way? I don't need most of these instructions now. Can I comment these out? Yeah. I think this is okay. In fact, let's just run it. That's what I get for thinking. I get so much for thinking. Remainder of minus 1, remainder of minus 3. What I meant to say... Oh, do I always need this? Yes, I do. That's what I meant to say. Jump greater than 0 to loop. Jump equal to 0 to loop. We can fail faster than ever. We're always off by 1. Again, minus 3? Third time's the charm? Okay. Let's change that back to minus 2. Change this back to minus 1. There we go, that's cleaner. I still don't understand why I've got to do this with a minus 2 at the beginning, but it works. Takes a ridiculous number of cycles. Only takes 5 nodes, so that's better than the average number of nodes used. It's really good in terms of instruction account, because I'm using JRO to do really clever things in terms of jumping exactly where I need to jump. In terms of cycle count, it's pretty awful. Like, what this should do, in the case where we discover... divisor of 1. Should just take the value from the left, print it out, take the value from the right, print it out, be done with that. I've got room for extra instructions. Because the divisor one, it's pretty clear. It'll always equally divide. Not only that, we know exactly how many times it equally divides. Can I do anything clever? No, not really. Yeah, there are clever ways to do this. I know, generally speaking, you just want to print out the two numbers. If one of them's the number one. Rather, you want to print out the number and then the digit zero. But in terms of actually coding that to make it happen, that's hard work. Like, you saw how hard it was just to get division working normally. And how many times they has to iterate in order to divide. And there are more clever ways to do division. I'm not sure if the instruction set that's provided by TIS-100 allows you to do more advanced math operations. Maybe it does. Another thing that could be done would be some clever manipulation. Like, you see how we have to loop and then swap the registers and add one and swap back and so forth. You could do like add two and then move it to the left twice. And then, yeah, let me show you what I'm talking about. I'm going to copy this program back in the segment list. Signal divider, copy over here. Instead of adding one, we're going to add two. And then move accumulator left twice. Now you'll say, well, that seems pretty crazy, right? Because we're going to get the wrong number when we're done. So what we need to do is have a loop down here, L2, or loop 2, if I have space for it. I can't fit the move minus one right instruction here. So move minus one right, add right, and if we're less than zero, JLZ back to L2. So what this'll do, this needs to indicate somehow, hang on, I'm missing a key piece of the puzzle here, and that's the step on the right, which is going to handle adding stuff from the left. Move left down is not... Wait. Left is the remainder. Right's the divisor. It's too much. It really is too much. There's no division operation that I can use. To simplify my life. Yeah. I think really just the divide by one thing would save a lot of steps. But I don't see a way to do it. Move right into accumulator is the first thing I'm doing. So I actually do have access to that value way up here. So I could say sub 1. Start.
jump start. End. Call this one. Oh, wait a minute. Yeah, that's not gonna work. Yeah, I don't have enough space on either of these notes to fit enough instructions to handle the special one case. That's a problem. Yeah, I have great ideas, but it would take a long, long time to move around all the instructions to get them to the point where I can do this optimization. And I don't think that's worth it. Yeah, one clever thing that could be done would be doing two division operations per cycle, which would cut the cycle count in half. And then two subtraction instructions per cycle, cut the cycle count in half. And then, if necessary, at the tail end of that, at that point, do some special math to put things back together. That would actually save way more cycles, I think, than the whole divide by one fiasco that's happening. Because other numbers, like dividing by two, take a long time also. But yeah, if I could just like add two and then move accumulator left twice, JRO left. Oh. Accumulator left twice. Okay, add an extra comparison here on the right, or left. I'm just trying to think of how I could do more operations per cycle. Actually, that'd be a 50% speed up at most. If I could do two subtractions per loop and then try to put things back together at the very end. That's not an enormous savings. The largest one would be the handle the special one situation, but I'm not seeing a clean way to do that. I'd have to introduce another node here and do some control flow and all that fun stuff. Move left down, move accumulator down, but at this point, what I could do here is say add or sub left, and accumulator right, move zero right. Which isn't exactly what we want. Because what we want to say is, actually, I want to go back to where I started. Okay, this is where I started. Sub left. Okay, and this is going to say move zero right, except when we're going to move one right instead. So this is going to be the offset. Oh, that's no good. Somehow I lost my cursor in there. So yeah, this move one right is our jump instruction. This move accumulator right. Whoa. Hold on. Hold the phone. Yeah, this reconstructing the value at the end is too messy. I'm not seeing a clean way to do it without rewriting everything. I keep thinking I find a way, and it keeps getting more complicated than I think. So just run it. It all works. It takes thousands more cycles than I would want it to take, but it does pretty well. I mean, it functions. It meets the objectives. That's signal divider. Signal window filter, by contrast, keeping track of the last three numbers and the last five numbers, it's going to cause me all kinds of mayhem. I'm not up for it at the moment. Maybe some other time. So, yeah, thanks for watching the video, and I hope to see you when my internet returns. Take care.